Welcome to E4 Electric, your number one source for what's happening now in the world of electric cars. Today we're gonna talk about a little bit of a sad of a story about Faraday Future. Their journey looks like it's coming to the end, but it's pretty shocking why. I don't think a lot of you guys kind of know what was going on behind the scenes. We're gonna talk about Toyota finally electrifying their fleet, and I'll tell you why they're still being disappointed to this industry. We're also going to talk about the BMW actually making more strides towards the electric future, and of course, comment of the day. And we're going to start right now. With that out of the way, I want to welcome those of you who are watching for the first time. If you're interested in staying up to date with everything that's going on in the universe of electric cars, you came to the right place. Please consider subscribing and hitting the bell notification icon so you don't miss anything moving forward, but most importantly, become a part of this community. Okay, so let's talk about the story of the day. As I see a lot of you getting into the chat, Gabriel from Berkeley, Rob from Australia, my girlfriend is watching from Los Angeles airport as she is coming home in a few hours. Isaac from New Zealand, Mr. Tech Freak 95 from Germany, Vit from Czech Republic, Monkey Ride from England, and it's just all over the world you guys are here, so I really appreciate it. All right, let's talk about Faraday Future. And as you know, this is a startup that started, you know, very aggressively, very sort of, it was a really good start. They've unveiled their car, FF91. That was their kind of a mainstream car at the CES. And it looked like they were actually having a promising future. And little by little by little, the lack of news, the lack of progress, the lack of the fact that they were able to build a factory has kind of started to weigh in on them. And people were starting wondering what was going on. They weren't able to secure their, you know, last round financing to finance their factory. And so things were kind of going worse and worse and worse. And now it looks like they are on the verge of bankruptcy. But here's the thing. A lot of stories started to come out about why they were really in a bad shape. And turns out that their CEO, so-called, I guess his nickname is YT. He's basically running a company. And he's also one of the investors, one of the major investors. He put a lot of his own money in there as well. I should probably turn my phone off when I do live shows. So he was never really kind of announced as a CEO. He kind of made himself a king and a CEO, started running the company. He has another company that he's kind of trying to run at the same time and having Faraday Future maybe even make cars for that company. He also put somebody in charge of finances who I guess didn't have that much experience in that, and that caused a lot of trouble. And now he's put on some sort of a blacklist by Chinese government because he owes, and his companies owe so much money to their investors. So he's actually not able to borrow money. He's not even able to like fly the first class, you know, by Chinese regulations and laws. And I don't know if there's politics. I'm sure there's some politics involved in that, but that is pretty bad. I mean, this guy seems to run this company sort of as his own kind of a thing without really any, I mean, a lot of people don't even think that he really wanted to get this car on the market. He just wanted to get rich. There were reports of him like using like $70 million for his kids' college fund. I mean, this is just crazy stuff that's going on. And this guy's not quitting. He's not going anywhere. He's just kind of there. If you remember, a lot of executives have already left. The last one to leave was their head designer, who also designed BMW i8 and i3. And so he went to Faraday Future to become the head designer. So he quit recently. And really, there's almost nobody left. People don't even want to come to work. So, but I found, I mean, there's just so many things coming out of this guy. And it's just so sad because it does look like they had some really good talent. It does look like they had some really good technology. And unless somebody just buys this, you know, company for their IP, which also doesn't even seem to be that likely if they owe so much money, it may not be worth it. Unless somebody buys them, they're just gonna waste this effort and become one of the failure stories like Solyndra back in the day of the green energy movement, of electric car movement. I mean, I guess it doesn't matter as much because we have so many success stories and we kind of finally starting to move in the right direction. But I found that this is something that I think it's a very sad story. Mr. Tech Freak 95 in the chat room says, I had a bad feeling for Faraday Future from the start on, you know, and a lot of people did, I guess. A lot of people like me stayed optimistic because, of course, I want electric cars to succeed. Gabrielle in the chat room says, Faraday spend too much money on things that nobody care, like Formula E. I mean, you know, of course, we can criticize them now, but a lot of electric cars, and I think, you know, Lucid is one of them, and a few other ones, wanted to make a lot of publicity kind of excitement, and they started making the, you know, limited edition racing cars or racing car versions, because that's how you get publicity, and a lot of people kind of pay attention. So they did that with their very first car. You know, yeah, I guess they wasted money now, but if that would have worked like it did for other companies, it would have been a good move. So, you know, just to be fair. But the car is, I mean, it's definitely had a lot of technology and a lot of promising things going on for them. So this would be just a shame. Cordero Jones in the chat room says, any news on Lucid Air? You know, Lucid Air is kind of staying tight. They said they're moving to the new headquarters. I have interesting report on my Patreon page about that, by the way, if you guys are interested. I wasn't going to mention it until later in the show, but I have a Patreon page. You can go and support the show. The link is down below in the description. And for those supporters who get the premium access, you guys can see something that I've reported, found out on my own about Lucid Air new headquarters. That's kind of interesting. But there's also a lot of behind the scene footage or wacky stuff, like me dancing with the Model X right here. It's kind of a funny but kind of a cool dance that I thought. So all right let's move on to the next story, and this is BMW. Now, as you know, BMW and a lot of other cars have kind of manufacturers kind of been lagging behind on the technology and everything. BMW committed to electrifying their fleet. As a matter of fact, they've invested some money into some of the factories and technologies, but today they are announcing that they are making a deal with a solid power company. That's a Colorado-based company, and that that company kind of was based on the technology that they came up with as a project of the university there. And so they're moving forward, and this is a solid state battery technology. And so BMW may just be making a very aggressive play for that technology, because as we know, this is something that people this is something that people are really believe that is going to be a future. Right now it's a lithium ion batteries, but people are saying that solid state batteries this is the future. Now there are some limitations there. There's, you know, it's not all yes for sure this is the future, but there are a lot of companies investing into this, and it looks promising. It looks like they can hold 2 to 3 times more energy. You can charge them faster. As you know, Fisker has already patented some of their technology, but won't be available until 2023. So we'll see, but BMW is definitely making a play for this, and it is obviously an exciting thing to see them finally invest, finally move forward with this. So kudos to them. All right, guys, I should probably remind you at this point, this video and this channel is brought to you by our sponsor, Evanex. They make accessories, aftermarket accessories for Tesla cars. So check them out. Of course, the link is in the description. Let's see. Mr. Tech Freak 95 says, solid state battery, how do they work? Still did not get, you know, I mean, I don't want to get into the nerd stuff, and I have to admit that I don't fully understand it, but this is just a different way how the chemistry works, where they can hold way more energy in the same sort of volume of the battery matter. A lot of it has to do with the capacitors. Capacitors are the, you know, sort of things, if you will, that hold that you can charge them really quick, but they don't hold energy for as long. So you kind of, they're part of the battery that just sucks the battery in there and then kind of redistributes it. Of course, solid state is a little different from lithium. That's just a different matter. And I can research more about it and so forth, but I think very few people really care about it, except for it is something that probably is going to be coming up. All right, guys, let's move on to the next story, which is Toyota. And you know, Toyota has been, back in the day, 10, 15 years ago, I thought they were on the cutting edge. You know, they're a luxury brand, the Lexus, at that time was kicking ass. They had touch screens, they had navigation system that was state of the art. When I had my Lexus LS 460L, That was about 10, 11 years ago. That car could park itself. Like what Tesla does now, they could do it 11 years ago, and that was amazing technology. They had it. But with every year, they kind of stopped innovating. They switched from touch screens back to the joystick, which I think is a huge mistake for everybody. And they just stopped innovating. They started having safety problems and other corruptions. Issues that came up, recalls, and you know, now we realize, Gabriel in the chat says, I hate Toyota. Who said that before, right? Nobody would say, I hate Toyota. So, and now we realize, and I'm sure they realize, that they're behind in this green technology. Now, their bet was on the hydrogen fuel cells. And they came out with a car, Mirai, and they're really selling it here in California. There's not enough charging stations or refuel stations for them. They recently admitted that that was a mistake, though they decided that they're still going to go forward with that. You're looking at the, I believe, Camry Hybrid right now in the video right here. But still, it's they just made all the wrong moves or non-moves at all times. But today, they said that they're coming, they are going as well. As everybody else basically already announced, electrify their fleet. And I was like, oh my God, finally Toyota is on board. I'm very excited to see, maybe they're going to innovate again and where it's going to go. But guess what? Their timeline is awful. Basically, they're saying they're going to start electrifying at 2020. They're going to electrify by 2025, which is way beyond, you know, behind everybody else. Because like Volvo are doing it by 2019, most of other car manufacturers are doing it by 2020. So it is really a tough timeline. And I believe by 2030, they're still like they're going to be fully electrified. And they're really, really betting on hybrid technology. And this is something that I think most people understand that that's going away. Look at Chevy Bolt. That's now sales are falling in favor of Chevy Bolt. Rolls-Royce recently announced that they're going straight to electric battery powered electric technology, and they're going to skip hybrid. So once again, Toyota unfortunately is kind of disappointing, and not only not getting this whole full electric revolution thing, refusing to innovate, but most importantly just doesn't understand the timeline, and I think they're going to fall behind as well. Broman says, I love the Prius. I've never heard too many people say, I love the Prius. I myself not a big fan of them just simply because of their looks and the fact that they're not very technologically advanced or really electric cars, if they're, even their plug-in version, but all right. For to each its own, man, to each its own. Cordero Jones in the chat room says, Toyota been on the decline since the 2011 tsunami. I you know, that's an interesting point. I'm not really sure if it had something to do with it. I think it's their vision was started to fall way before that. I think it's about the vision, really. Q-tip Shark says, China is setting up to be number one electrification manufacturing scale that are going super aggressive with infrastructure. That is correct. China is really, really, and you know, there are two things there, right? The Chinese government is very aggressive about providing incentives. And, you know, we were just talking about, you know, I just knew that I should not remove the slide from my deck. But, you know, this NIO car, right? This is something that's, you know, one of the products of Chinese private investments, right? And a lot of other companies have invested, Chinese companies invested in electric cars. But this one actually just kind of sprung on us just the other day. It looks like they're going to start producing this car in large amounts, in large quantities next year. But, you know, so Chinese government is providing aggressive incentives to the buyers and to the companies who are going to be making and selling them. On another hand, a lot of investors and private companies, private investment companies in China are betting on this technology as well and investing heavily as well. So that is something that we're definitely going to see in China. May just bypass everybody, though. Tesla is going to be opening their own wholly owned factory there at some point. So that's a big win for Tesla, though they'll still have to pay a ridiculously high tariff. And that's why it's going to be really tough for them to compete with this car that really is with an option of battery leasing. So without the battery being sold, it's going to be priced at $42,000 compared to like $140,000 that the Model X, its competitor, is already being sold in China. So there's going to be tough times for Tesla in China. So it is definitely Tony in the chat room says Toyota fell asleep at the wheel. It's true. And he says too long at the top. Yeah, when you're kicking ass and when you're at the top, it's really easy to get lazy and complacent. I think BMW is in that camp as well. Though, as we know by that story that I was just talking to, telling you guys today, they are making some good progress. So kudos to them. All right, guys. So this is definitely exciting. There are more news coming up. Don't forget, I will be on a vacation, so my last show is going to be in 2 days. On Thursday, in 3 days. And after that, I will be doing eWords, which are electric car awards that I made up. We're going to have some categories. We're going to announce the winners. Some of them are the sexiest electric vehicle feature of the year, or the performance of the year, many other categories. Patreons are going to be voting of which category will be exclusively just for them, and those are going to be pre-taped videos, and I will be back on the 30th. I will answer one more question. Corridor Jones in the chat room says, hey Alex, what do you expect the Model Y specs have to be in order for you to compete and be successful? You know, I think if they build Model Y on the specs of Model 3, really just going to be the same of everything, and maybe do a Falcon Door option, not standard option, I think they can definitely compete. And if it stays within that range, maybe starts at 40,000, I think they will do very well. So I think I'm hopeful for that, but I don't expect any announcements at least later in the next, into the next year. All right, guys, as usual, it's nice hanging out with you. And I will be coming back here tomorrow at 11 a.m. Hope to see you then. But for now, remember to stay charged.